the former revolutions, like the Russian or the French Revolution, etc., they concentrated on destroying exterior structures like society, church, village, governing institutions. But the sexual revolution and the fourth revolution goes after the internal structures inside society, which is identity, logic, being. You know, they wanted annihilation, self-annihilation. So it is a much more radical application of that. And that's what you see in the sexual revolution, saying, well, before I didn't like those people who were governing me. Now I don't like even my own being, my the nature that governs me. So I want to destroy that nature.
Joyful, joyful.
Hi, everyone. I'm Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse, and welcome to this edition of the Dr. J Show. I am recording this on October the 9th, is it? Today's October the 9th, and Hurricane Delta is hurtling towards Lake Charles. And so I am at an undisclosed location in Houston, waiting for the storm and preparing to interview my good friend, John Horvat II. John is the author of this book, Return to Order, which is how I got to know him some years ago. And John's a scholar, a researcher, educator, international speaker, and author whose works have been appearing worldwide for decades. He's been researching the causes and solutions of America's socioeconomic decline, an effort that culminated in this book. He heads the Tradition Family Property Commission for American Studies, and he lives near York, Pennsylvania. And the Tradition Family Property Group is a very good friend of ours here in Louisiana. We've gotten to know the group, I guess they're called TFP South. We've gotten to know that group of guys very well. And John, welcome so much to the Dr. J Show.
It's great to be on the show. Very, very, very good.
Always. Well, good. You know, this book, what I remember is that you and I met each other at a... It was a CPAC. I think it was a CPAC. You pressed this book into my hands.
Oh, my gosh.
And so I took it home, and I had not heard of you. I had not heard of TFP. I think I put two and two together that you were the guys who showed up with those cool banners that's behind your head. Those cool banners that you showed up at one of the March for Marriage in Washington, D.C. But you gave me this book, and I went home and read it, and I thought, wow, this is really, really interesting. What I found interesting about it is it's a defense of the free market without going whole hog into libertarianism or materialism or individualism. And I like the way you blended that. And I want to say it was about, it's been quite a few years. I want to say 2000.
We're 7 years out. It's been 7 years.
You wrote it in 2013, is that right?
Yes, it was launched in 2013.
And so the reason I wanted to talk with you and that I think our listeners are going to find interesting is that you've been concerned about the topic of revolution for some time. And what we're seeing today in late 2020 is not rioting, not protesting. We're seeing a full-on insurgency. And so I'd like you to just give your perspective on that. That's what I think is going on. And I think I learned some of that from you. I'd like you to give your perspective on revolution and what we're seeing here in the U.S.
Right. I think you put it well. This is not just rioting. It's not just, some kind of disturbances. I think all political battles, when you come down to it, are moral battles. And this is a moral crisis that has long been in our society, especially accentuated by the 60s, which really took us down a long slope.
Right.
But as you said, it's a revolution. A revolution means not just a tweaking of the system or changing of the system. It wants to overthrow the system and replace it with another system in place. So that is what I think we're seeing today. It is an effort on the part of the left to say we don't want the American order as it has stood for so long. We want something completely different, and that something completely different is extreme. I think it's going to be is something we've never seen before, and it is very dangerous.
Yes, and the reason you're so interesting on this subject is that your concern with this and your analysis of this greatly predates Black Lives Matter. It predates Antifa. It precedes mm-hmm. The current round of crisis. You've been thinking about this for a long time, and so the things we're seeing now are kind of a working out of, or I don't want to say superficial, but they're like symptoms of something deeper. And I think people are interested in the something deeper, John. So when you said the 60s really gave it a push downhill, it was mm-hmm. going before that. What was the going before that, as you see it?
Right. Yeah, that's a good point, because a lot of people think, well, it was just the 60s and the 50s was heaven, you know, and it really wasn't. In the book, from an economic and a culture point of view, in the book Return to Order, I trace it back to the Industrial Revolution. The Industrial Revolution being not so much because of its technological advances and the inventions that definitely helped mankind, but the manner in which it took place, where it overturned societies and villages and places and created a lot of societal chaos that was reflected very much in the 19th century, and Leo XIII wrote several encyclicals to try to remedy those situations. So one of the places where we can go back to is the Industrial Revolution as a means to, which brought on a lot of the modern, what I call the frenetic intemperance of our economy and our culture that pushes forward a movement where people just want everything now, instantly, regardless of the consequences. Now we're just seeing an acceleration of processes that began way back. You know, today they would seem just almost, just so slow, but at the time they were processes that pushed things ahead.
So you know, one of the things that's interesting about that, what jumped out at me as an economist, I've been a free market economist my whole life, my imaginary right. whole life, you know. And so generally when I see somebody attacking the Industrial Revolution, what I'm expecting next is, therefore, we must have collective ownership of the means of production, we must have Marx. Mm-hmm. that's generally what you're dealing with when somebody says there was a problem with the Industrial mm-hmm. Revolution. And I and many of my friends for a long time defended the Industrial Revolution and said, look, there were a lot of good things that came from it. You're looking at this in a myopic manner. So it was mm-hmm. very helpful to me to see somebody take the kind of what I would call a balanced approach to it, you know, to see that right. there were some good things, but there was also something badly distorted and badly mistaken. So say a little bit more of it. You used a term that I think we should flesh out a little bit. Frenetic intemperance, is that the term you use?
Yes, that's the term.
So yeah, tell us about that.
Right. The church, for example, has never been against progress. The Middle Ages was called the First Industrial Revolution because it was an explosion of technology and all sorts of things were happening at that time that just really advanced science, progress, technology was really going forward. So, you know, there's no problem with those things. What we're seeing, though, is that much more the temperamental and this idea of intemperance. Temperance is the virtue whereby one acts according to the reason and the intellect and acts in rational and reasonable manners to obtain the goals that we need to obtain. With the Industrial Revolution, a lot of these things were just, you know, were freneticized, was just turned upside down. And, that is what I'm talking about when I talk about frenetic intemperance, these movements that take an economy that, like our own economy, which functions reasonably well, but at certain points it takes it and puts everything out of balance. So that you have, money cycle, economic cycles that go up and down, you know, where you have booms and busts that you didn't normally have in times before that, because there are these, you might even call them market corrections, because when you do put things out of balance, the system reacts and you have depressions and recessions and other things like that. Whereas if you had a balanced society, those things would not nearly take place as often and not be as harmful to society as they are today.
And the other aspect that is helpful, I think, is that as soon as you use the word temperance, you're obviously now in the realm of talking about virtue. Mm-hmm. And one thing that we were always kind of allergic to talking about as free market economists is virtue. We're not supposed to talk about virtue. We're supposed to talk about people's preferences being given.
Right.
And then we're just going to achieve our preferences in the least cost manner. Well, nobody ever asked the question, well, where do those preferences come from?
Right.
We're acting in our self-interest, but nobody's really taking responsibility for the content of the self.
Right, you know?
And those were the questions that I got interested in when I started having children, and I had mm-hmm. to be responsible for their development. Mm-hmm. Gee, this is not helping. This free market stuff is not, I mean, it's good, but it's not helping on this particular point. And that's when I ended up starting to drift away from a lot of my old colleagues because they couldn't really understand what I was talking about. So tell us more about the role of virtue and what you see as an ordered society as opposed to a frenetic society. Talk more about virtue.
Right. Virtue is very important because an economy should never have been separated from virtue. Economy does deal with the production and consumption of goods and services and does deal with a lot of technical aspects. But at the same time, it does have that link to virtuous action in some way determines outcome. Now, everybody says that, Adam Smith was the founder of modern economics, but Adam Smith was not an economist. He was a moral philosopher. And so he did know something about morality. That was part of his field. And if you trace economic thought back, I don't care who it is. The libertarians do the same thing. Austrians, you name any school of economics, they all go back to the school of Salamanca.
Right.
And school of Salamanca was a school of Spanish theologians in the 14th, 15th, 16th century that developed a lot of economic thought and did it in a way which was amazing. They developed economic theories that are even today pretty much still stand. And so everybody goes back to Salamanca. It goes back to that religious and moral foundation which all economy needs to happen. And so, yes, I think virtue is very, very important. And it was only because of virtue that the ideas of economy were systematized, like at Salamanca, and then later on, economies were able to expand and to go according to systems of laws, education, and economy that were founded upon Christian civilization. We owe very much to Christian civilization when we talk about economy, education, health, all these fields.
So when you see virtue and moral reasoning becoming separated from economic analysis and economic thinking, where do you see that taking place? What would be one of the crucial points where that disconnect would start?
It's hard to give a timeline. I mean, Hobbes evidently was very much, he did separate a lot of the reasonable aspects, even of moral and governments and state and philosophy. He said the will is what determines how things should function and not the reason. So I would say around the time of the Enlightenment, a lot of the Enlightenment thinkers, they did deal with a lot of those questions where they separated it. Although it took a long time for all that was stored up on Christian civilization to gradually fade away. I mean, obviously Keynes, he's right. Way, way farther. And today, today you look at economics, and I generally don't look at modern economics because it's merely algorithms and equations and mathematics. It doesn't really have anything to do with life as we live it, as we see it, as it should be.
One thing that one aspect that I see is that around the so-called progressive era of the turn of the 20th century, many fields of study were becoming professionalized into technocracies. So economics now, we economists thought of ourselves as kind of the queen of the social sciences or whatever, and that we were the real scientists and everybody else was, poets or, something frivolous like that,
Right.
Not realizing that the poets are actually less frivolous than the technocrats. But anyway, that's a side thing. But we are ruled by technocrats right now.
Part of what
progressivism sought was to say, well, we have expertise, we have experts, we're going to, that's good government. Good government is to be ruled by science.
Science and experts, and separated from moral decisions, and that's what really turns everything upside down and gets us all into the trouble which we're in.
And that's the coronavirus writ large. That's the coronavirus.
Yeah, everything that could go wrong, it has gone wrong, science is the one that's engineering this, and you know, people just don't want to face the fact, you know, that we have to deal with it in a much more human way, in a much more moral way.
That's right. That science cannot solve the problems for us of deciding what we're going to do, who we're going to be as people, you know.
Right. Yeah. Exactly. I mean, these are all the physical sciences and all the other, and even the economic sciences, social sciences. They are subordinated to the moral and the ethical and even the theological when you come down to it. Those are the higher sciences which should direct the other sciences, and that's what we're not seeing today. Everybody's on their own.
So let's do talk a little bit more about revolution and order. Mm-hmm. When you talk about returning to order, talk to people about what's the order that you're, are we returning to something? Are we creating something completely new? Is there something inherent that you're looking for? What do you mean when you say return to order?
Yeah, order is the state of affairs whereby something functions according to its nature. So human nature does not change, and so we're not inventing something new. I mean, the socialists invented something new. All the modern philosophies try to invent something new, which usually just rehashes something old, but they call it new. But in any case, what I mean by order is that order desired by God that is according to our nature, and is very much based on the principle of natural law. Natural law is something that's not taught anymore in most of the legal schools, but it is those set of moral principles by which one should direct one's life that are valid for all times and all peoples and all places. You know, it's always wrong to steal. It's always wrong to lie. It's always wrong to do this. It's always wrong to do that. I mean, these are very basic things that exist in our human nature and provide the framework for some type of order. And that's what I'm talking about when I talk about order. A society based on natural law, based on the natural God-given institutions of faith, family, and community that God gave us so that we could live together in society and in virtue, and to help us in that journey, because we can't do it alone. We need society, we need people, we need the greatest possible combination of networks to help us in this to along the way, because that is the way in which we will make it to heaven, which is our final goal.
Right, that's how we make it to heaven. That's also how we make it through the day, you know.
Yes, that's true.
which I've learned after living through a hurricane.
Right.
I'm very grateful for the whole concept of order. I've been thinking about you a lot since the whole power grid went down in Lake Charles, okay?
Right, right.
Right? So just think about this, just as an instance of what you're talking about, John. Lake Charles, Louisiana, not a huge place, but 100,000 people, a nice modern city. Right?
Yes.
The whole power grid goes down all at once, okay? And so now I'm thinking to myself, oh, our anarchist friends should be very happy. Mm-hmm. There's no, you know, there's nothing oppressive going on. We should all be able to live one with nature, commune with nature, each one take responsibility for themselves. Our libertarians will be excited because we're all...
Yeah, the market is free to work however it wants to, yeah.
That's it. You know, we've burned the whole thing down and we could start over, you know, which is what the revolutionary impulse is. You know,
right.
and then I'm thinking, you know, the sun has gone down and I can't find my toothbrush. Mm. I don't know where my toothbrush is because there's no light. I go in, I flip the light switch, no light. I'm looking at the counter, I'm going like this on the counter, I can't find, right? Everything that you think you know where it is, it's not there. So the result of that is you have to take an enormous amount of work and effort just to perform the daily tasks of daily life, just mm-hmm. to get water, just to find mm-hmm. Gas for your generator, just to have ice for your cooler so your food doesn't freeze. And you're thinking, okay, so now I'm supposed to do this all by myself. with no one to help me, with no community, with no, you know. And then you're right. And literally thousands of men in trucks are coming in to restore the power grid.
Right, yeah.
And look at the capital that is represented by even one of those trucks. You know, they couldn't do squat by themselves. So right. that system of social cooperation, that's what makes it all possible to live the kind of life that we're comfortable with.
Right, and the funny thing is that a lot of times that those networks are networks that are not costly. You know, the family does not cost. I mean, it does not ask for payment, you know, for things that happen. The community, many times, they work together and don't, you know, they do it for free. The church or the parish is you know, just a constant receptacle or dispenser of charity. So, you know, these are things that it's not this mechanical way of living. It's very natural way of living. It's something that is very what I'm proposing by order is not something that's hard or for difficult or something that is against our nature and our way of being. It's something that's very according to our nature. It's something very agreeable when it's done and done correctly. And you know, and people should not, you know, it's you shouldn't be afraid of it. It's nothing to be afraid of. It's actually something that we should embrace, and we naturally do tend to embrace.
Yes. And you know, I think a lot of times people think, well, if you're advocating order, you're advocating some great man on a horse to come in and ride to the rescue and impose order from the top.
Right.
That's what people are afraid of. But the fact is that if you don't have these organic sources of order, you're more likely to get the guy on the horse imposing everything from the top down, right?
Right, right. No, that's exactly true. You can't legislate. You can impose that kind of order. Those are things. These are kind of things that naturally come up. There are natural leaderships. There are natural leaders that appear in society that we need to take. We need to pay attention to. But I mean, real leadership is not imposing. Real leadership is service, and everybody who's a leader knows that. And so, especially in a Christian context. And that's why you do need that type of religious orientation, because if it is just for yourself and you are getting something out of this and your self-interest is definitely being advanced, it's very hard to prevent, you know, corruption and these demagoguery to enter in. Whereas if you're doing something for the common good and for God and for the glory of God, that changes the whole dynamics, the whole chemistry of a society.
Two things that come to mind. One is the whole idea of equality versus hierarchy, because that's something we're uncomfortable with. And the other is corruption and self-interest. So what I'd like you to do is let's start with the whole concept of corruption, of people seeking leadership positions in order to advance their own self-interest. I'm a little bit self-conscious about this because in economics, that's all we have.
That's all you talk about, yeah.
Right. And we were claiming that if everybody pursued their own self-interest, everything would work out in the end. And I figured out that couldn't be true with respect to the family and children because people do all kinds of things don't serve other people's interests or don't serve the interests of the whole. But say something about the proper sense of self-interest or maybe how this concept has gotten corrupted or does it need to be thrown out completely? I mean, maybe it does need to be.
Well, I mean, there is a legitimate self-interest because we have to take care of ourselves. We have to do what's necessary for ourselves and our families to advance and to survive and to even to prosper. But the modern economics is exactly that. It is, you know, make money, you know, maximize profits and then get your quarterly reports in, make sure everything is, you know, is always going ahead and regardless of who it hurts in the process. So yeah, the modern tendency, especially individualism, the individualist tendency is to say, the world is me and everyone around me is an instrument for my self-advancement and my self-interest. And of course that is wrong. And nobody can really survive in a situation like that. And so, you know, I think that even in companies where you have people who have been ingrained this idea has been put in their minds, the business schools and all the things they've read and all the business literature out there, that at a certain point, a real businessman has to take care of his employees. He has to realize, he says, well, I'm going to have to sacrifice these employees. I have to help this one when he's down. I have to make them part of a family, you know, of sorts, in a very broad sense. And then things will start working a lot better. I mean, people have to realize that in any organization, whether it be a university, a school, a church, even in government should have something like that. It tends to be very bureaucratic today. So yeah, these are the things that self-interest can be legitimate, but at the same time, people eventually have to realize that it's not all about them, and we need to work together with others and help others, because no man is an island. You know, the Hobbes said everybody's just a piece of sand, and this idea of isolation. We're feeling that isolation today, and right. It's brutal.
Back to the concept of individualism, you know, there's a proper Christian self-interest. There's mm-hmm. a proper Christian individualism.
Right.
Let's speak about that individualism for a moment, because for me as a young person, this was something that was very attractive to me about, for instance, Ayn Rand. I had an Ayn Rand problem, you know, and for a while.
Yes, of course.
What was appealing about it was that I felt that I had been asked to sacrifice my interests for the sake of something bigger than myself, but it wasn't really bigger than myself. I was being taken advantage of, right? Mm. And her critique of socialism was very powerful when it was, it's asking you to sacrifice yourself for the sake of this collective. Mm. And that's not what proper Christian individualism does. That's not what, her alternative is not proper, but the thing she was critiquing is also not deserve to be critiqued.
Right. Yeah, I mean, I prefer to call, a Christian individualism to be more individuality. You know, we have an individuality whereby we are different from others. And we have sort of an obligation to develop our individuality, to take those talents that God gave us and to develop them to their fullness. And that is, there's nothing wrong with that. God gave us those talents as he wants us to use it. He doesn't want us to bury them in the ground or to put them under a bushel basket. We are called to shine upon our virtues. So, there is that legitimate individualism that needs to be developed, and you can get pretty excited about it if you can develop your talents in ways and to their fullest. And so, yeah, I'm all for that. But the individualism of the modern world is to say, I'm going to develop myself. And it doesn't necessarily mean virtues. It can mean vices as well. So you develop your vices. You grow in vice, and you can, you take advantage of other people. And that's the part of the individualist, ethos. And it's wrong. That's absolutely wrong. The individuality is a growth in virtue and talents, but as opposed to the other.
And the collectivism that somebody like Ayn Rand would be critiquing, mm-hmm. it's proper that be critiqued, because
yes, absolutely.
It's not an organic group that we're talking about. We're really talking about the artificial construction of a society that requires mm-hmm. people to sacrifice their true selves in order for it to work. Whereas the kind of organic situation, the organic society that you're talking about, there's cooperation, there's collaboration, there is a larger whole mm-hmm. that you have some obligation to. But it doesn't crush you. It's not asking you to crush yourself or
Right, exactly that. And in that's where the Christian context is very important, because, we are called to love God above all things, but we're also called to love our neighbor for the love of God. And that gives us an extra incentive to love our neighbor, because we naturally don't tend to do that. We do look after ourselves. So God gives us another push in that direction, says, well, love God with your whole heart, your whole mind, your whole strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. But you do that out of love of God, and that really gives a lot more incentive for us to do that than if we were just on our own to say, well, love your neighbor, well, why should I, But if God's involved, it definitely pushes us in that direction.
Another thing that that I want to pick up on when you're talking about developing the talents and so on is the concept of equality. You know, equality is another one of these terms that there's a proper Christian equality, and then there's this thing we have in the modern world that is not proper at all, which is a real distortion of something. And one place that I notice it in the analysis of the family and talking to families and living in a family, you know, as a young woman, I had the idea that I needed to be equal to my husband. I needed to be equal to the guys, you know, and it took a long time to sort out that being equal wasn't really going to work, you know, that in order to be equal, I had to suppress parts of myself in order to have things not matter to me the same way. Your children matter to you in a different way as a mother than to the father, or that they certainly matter to a stranger. You know, I had colleagues, John, I had colleagues telling me that I really shouldn't bother staying home taking care of my children. That they wasn't really important. I mean, you know, they literally were talking to me like that. And so it just took a long time to sort out that that to be yourself, you can't be equal to anybody. You know, if you're looking over your shoulder, am I equal to him? Is he better than me? You know, if you're doing all that, you're never going to be yourself in the end.
No. And there are the basic equality that exists in human nature, that everybody is equal as far as their right to life, their right to living conditions, the right to practice religion, practice the faith. Those are basic equalities that exist in law and need to be respected, and God, you know, that God put them there as a part of our nature. But there's a whole world of inequalities that exist. The minute somebody exists, you know, everybody's different. Everybody has different talents, and everyone has different abilities, and everyone's, you know, some people are tall, some are short, some can do this, some can do that. And that's what makes life interesting, you know, and to say that, you know, to suppress those equalities, those inequalities, is wrong. You know, if someone has leadership abilities, why not let them have those leadership abilities? And, you know, we should incentivize those, because that's what makes things prosper, when you allow everybody to develop themselves unequally, because we are that way. And, you know, to take care of those who cannot do things, and to help them to go upward. And even more important is to look upward and to admire those people who can do things that you cannot do, and say, God be blessed, praise be God, that he can do those things. And he does them in such a better, much better than I can do it. And he writes much better. He paints much better. He does music much better. Isn't that wonderful? You know, but an egalitarian society says, no, I hate anybody who's more than me. And I even, you know, and that is what destroys the harmony in society. Societies are harmonious when those different inequalities are harmonized by the church and harmonized by our mutual admiration and mutual assistance to one another because of our shortcomings.
And the desire for everything to be equal in part came out of the desire to equalize incomes. And, you know, maybe I'm particularly sensitive to this because of the economics background. That's what we spend a lot of time on. Well, the incomes are unequal. What are we going to do about that? Well, the answer is, you know, in the end, the answer is, well, that by itself isn't enough to be worried about. You know, I mean, there are things to be worried about, but people's differences in talents and inclinations, situations and all that, that's all okay. You know, those kinds of differences are okay.
Right, and it's part of justice. Justice is to give that which is due to a person. And if a person gives more, he should be paid more. I mean, it's very basic justice that needs to be, needs to be practiced.
And that leveling tendency that has been part of society for a long time, you know, and really that goes back hundreds of years also. And I would like us to talk about that very point, the whole idea of a hierarchy. Okay, because as Catholics, we're kind of okay with hierarchies, you know, in a way that other people aren't.
Right.
And what I've lately noticed is that we have hierarchies in the United States of America.
Yeah.
But they're not responsible to anyone.
And they're hidden.
They're not accountable to anyone. Right? Mm-hmm. So Jeff Bezos or an NBA star or, you know, people who have lots of power and money, influence, they're not accountable to anybody. Talk to people a little bit about that in the more organic vision that you have.
Right. Yeah, no, that's a very good point because, there are a lot of rich people in America. There are a lot of gated communities that keep people separate. But the natural inorganic society is for the social classes to live together among each other, helping each other and elevating everybody together. The hierarchies exist because, they are like teachers. They're like people who help you, who push you forward, there's nothing wrong with having that type of hierarchical relationship. And they are a way in which they can help us to God as well. Because we see in these people qualities that remind us of God. And so we say, well, I admire this. God must be much, much more than that. So it is something very natural to our human nature to go into hierarchies. And if you look at any group of people, if you put them all together in a period of time, hierarchies will start appearing.
Right.
It was funny. I had some friends that were stranded in Canada during 9/11. They were on the plane. They went down in Canada. They were put in this camp in the middle of nowhere, and they said, "Well, all of a sudden we were a society, and we needed to get things done." And the person said, "You know who the people were who got things done? The people in the first class, because they were used to doing that." They're helping people. They're the ones that rolled up their things. They were not thinking about themselves. They weren't saying, how am I going to get out of this? They were the ones who started things going. And so they had a little hierarchy there, because they were serving the others, and not thinking about only their own individual ways.
Right. So there's an element of talent and an element of what they were used to doing. They're used to sizing up a situation and saying, nothing's going to happen unless I do it, so I better turn to it.
Unless I want to reassure you, this is something that can be dealt with. They have those talents. They have those abilities. And, we do. And the modern society says, no, they shouldn't have them. And so, as you said, they're many times they are hidden. They just hide away into these gated communities. We definitely have hierarchies in America because we would not have a prosperous economy if we didn't have people who got things done and elites that push things ahead. We have flourishing elites in America, but they're all hidden. And the modern culture and the modern media has this myth that everybody's pretty much the same. And there's Bezos up here, but those are sort of the exceptions. But there is a graduated, hierarchy in society today, and these people get things done, and they are some of them are natural, others are not so natural. They just get their money somewhere else, or the rock stars, the sports players, the other players. I mean, they definitely have talents and abilities, but the compensation is really debatable.
But my point is that those people who are exercising influence and leadership, in some cases, they don't perceive that they have a responsibility.
Right. Oh, no, they're taught not to.
That's right.
They say, well, okay, I have my making money. That's it.
Yeah. So there's kind of a fiction that the NBA stars are the same as everybody else. Nobody says to them, hey, listen, you guys, when you get picked up on a drug charge, or when you get picked up on a battery charge because you beat the crap out of your girlfriend, that matters. You guys, come on, cut it out. Mm-hmm. There's no sense that they should be thinking like that. They're making money for the league. I guess that's how the league and the advertising.
And those natural leaders should also think in terms that they are models for other people.
Exactly.
And they should behave accordingly.
Exactly.
They should not be doing the things they're doing.
That's exactly right. And I find that that people don't even know how to think about hierarchy or leadership in a way. And it's inspiring in a way to think back to the Catholic Middle Ages when you had this feudal society, which most people don't really know very much about it. They have an image of it as being ranked and therefore bad and therefore unequal and so on and so forth. But people forget that slavery was gone in that society. There was no slavery. Shadow slavery was killed off by Christian civilization.
Absolutely.
And it came back later.
Yeah. Right? Later on.
Right.
Enlightened.
That medieval society was a system of mutual obligations, mutual rights and obligations. You didn't, the guy at the top didn't get to tell you to wear a face mask. You know, he didn't tell you to have a seatbelt on your horse. You know, the guy at the top had limited rights.
Right. Yeah, it was a society that very much tailored to relationships. And that's what we're missing today. You know, they're saying, well, I will help you. I want to help you. You also will help me. We have a mutual relationship here. We have that's beyond just the mechanical or even the monetary. It's even affection, the relationships of affection, of persons that, you know, that you've served my family for generations. We've been together for generations. We've worked together for generations. And how these things were very beautiful, and they helped to get for society to progress, because you had that continuity that is so necessary for progress to happen.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So talk to us more about what we see around us today. It seems to me you wrote recently a very interesting article about the Portland rioters and the guillotine. Was it you who wrote the article about the
guillotine? Yes.
Well, I think our listeners would be interested in what you have to say about that.
Well, I mean, what we're seeing in the Portland riots and a lot of these riots is what we talked about earlier, revolution. And it's very disconcerting to see that the symbols of past revolutions are appearing. The guillotine was a symbol of the French Revolution, which was a very bloody revolution. Most Americans probably don't realize how bloody it was. You know, just so many people were of all classes, of all types, of, you know, priests, religious, you know, you name it, they were guillotined, and they were simply because they showed some education, because they showed they might have had money at some point in their lives. These were. And so what you're seeing is now is that some of these protesters and rioters are going through neighborhoods, you know, carrying a guillotine around, or going in front of Jeff Bezos' properties and saying, "You're next. We want you down." It is a very egalitarian society. It's a destruction of the idea of order in society, and saying, "Well, we want a society where we do what we want. We want no one telling us to do. We want no morality. We want the CHAZ, the CHAP, whatever you want to call it, you know, these autonomous, very radical, egalitarian society, which always leads to some type of bloodshed and always leads to some type of general disorder in society.
So, but the idea that you're going to have nobody's going to tell us what to do, but you're still walking around with guillotines, suggests that somebody is going to be telling somebody what to do.
I mean, right, it's sort of the opposite. You know, we're talking about the hidden elites that don't tell us what to do, you know, that get things moving, but they don't tell us. They have, in those types of societies, they don't like leaders a lot of times. You look at the CHAZ that was set up in Seattle, that autonomous zone. You don't find, you find one or another persons, but you don't find a real leader that says, "I'm imposing my will." But they have ways. It's a sort of a mystical experience that takes place, and where they move in a direction, and it's definitely taking a direction. There's definitely intelligence behind that direction, but they hate hierarchy so much that nobody really wants to be the leader. They say, "Well, I will be a comrade. I'll be this. I'll be that." They'll give themselves another title, but they won't take that of, you know, somebody in charge.
But in the Russian Revolution and communism, properly understood as we would understand it from 1917 on,
yes,
definite leadership is always there. I mean, and then gap between the leaders
and that was a revolution that needed those leaders to break the society, because it was a very organized society and a very hierarchical society. So they did need those types of people to get things done and to move things and to destroy things and destroy society. So yes. You know, there it is a phase of the revolution,
but it would seem like the current situation really is ripe for somebody, for the strong man to come in and take over and lead it.
It could very well be, because there are people do despite everything, despite the psychological damages that are so great in our country, there are people always yearn for order. Order is the first need of the soul. That's you know, anytime you're in a situation of chaos, the first thing you want is order. You don't want justice. You don't want law. You don't want this. You don't want that. You want to establish some kind of situation where order will be put in place. And so a lot of people simplify and say, well, strong man will do it.
Mm-hmm.
But it could backfire quite easily.
Yes. You know, I come at all these questions of revolution through the lens of the sexual revolution. Capitalizing the sexual revolution, like the French Revolution right? Because in my view, the sexual revolution has been every bit as destructive, every bit as world significant, and no one's taking responsibility for it. So at the very least, we can say it's a thing, and we need to define it as a thing, you know? And what you see there, it's more clear, I think, in the sexual revolution, some of the earlier, is the way in which it is a war on human nature. The direct assault on human nature.
Right, yeah.
Your body is not significant. The fact that I have a female body is not
right.
significant. And I can overwrite that, and I can reconstruct it, and I'll be just as fine a man as you are. By the time the doctors are done with me, you know, I can be a man as much as you are, John. And so it's a full-on assault on human nature. And so you think it has to fail. It has to fail. It can't possibly succeed. But the attempt to do that is really significant. And it takes a lot of power. And the people trying to do it have to accumulate a lot of power.
Yeah.
And I think for some of them, that's the buzz. I don't know how much they actually mean it or believe it or want it. But bossing people around, going after people over pronouns, they're getting a buzz out of that.
Well, I mean, it's very interesting you mentioned that, because the former revolutions, like the Russian or the French Revolution, etc., they concentrated on destroying exterior structures like society, church, village, governing institutions, which are exterior structures that influence our interior. But the sexual revolution and the fourth revolution goes after the internal structures inside society, which is identity, logic, being. You know, they wanted annihilation, self-annihilation. So it is a much more radical application of that, and that's what you see in the sexual revolution. Saying, well, before I didn't like those people who governed me. Now I don't like even my own being, the nature that governs me. So I want to destroy that nature.
And then, but what we don't realize is that every step we take along that path, we're sitting ducks for some truly totalitarian thing, you know, whether it's a person or a set of ideas or whatever it is. You know, those children whose parents couldn't stay together, you know, the children who are brought up without a sense of identity or stability or love, those kids are so vulnerable. They're vulnerable to so many different things.
Exactly.
Yeah,
and it's a tyranny. It's a true tyranny that they put themselves in, because they've given in to the tyranny of the passions, and the passions turn upon them and say, well, now you have to do what we say. You have to satisfy us, because you have given in and you have taken this to a point that has never been taken before. You know, like we're seeing today with the, you know, destroying identity and pronouns and this and that, you know, just the logic and language, all these things that are so important to existence.
Right, and to an ordered mind. You know,
ordered mind, that's absolutely, yeah.
Yeah, even to an ordered mind. I read somewhere, John, I don't know if this is something you follow, but Jeffrey Epstein, his victims, the women who are now coming forward and giving information and testimony and so on, one of the things they said was that these people who went around procuring girls to you know, for his use, they targeted kids from broken families.
Oh, yeah.
They targeted foster children. They targeted them, you know? Mm-hmm. And you think, these are the people making public policy that have the effect of family breakdown, and they're literally and directly exploiting those kids. That's horrible.
Right. No, it would make sense that they do that, because part of the work is already done for them, because these people have, there is a disorder there that entered in, not through their fault many times, but because they don't have that safety net. They don't have all those networks of order that are so so necessary to make a person, you know, to develop to his full, to the fullness.
Tell us a little bit about Tradition Family Property as an organization and how people can learn more about it. But just explain to people why those three things, Tradition Family Property, and what do you guys do and that kind of stuff.
Okay, the American Society for the Defense of Tradition Family Property, we're a civic organization of laymen who of Catholic inspiration, and we base ourselves upon the teachings, the traditional teachings of the church, to defend these three basic principles. Tradition is very important because it is the way in which we progress in society and progress in our in the development and progress toward our final goal. Family is very important because it is that place where everything is learned inside the family. Everything is your whole personality is formed on it. And property is important because it is a platform which the family and tradition are built. If you don't have properties, you won't be able to build a family or to have those traditions that will be carried forth. You can't pass anything on, physically can't pass anything on. And these three basic values have always been defended by the church, and you know, but you can find that the encyclicals, especially those of Leo XIII, he talks about these three values. And they are the foundation of a Christian civilization. And so we defend these because we see that they are especially vulnerable by communism and socialism, but in all aspects of our life, we need to defend them. So we do this through books and publications. We do this through talks, campaigns on the street, street activism, university activism, called chivalry camps for boys, you know, all sorts of activities. We need to have very affirmative values that people can identify with. And so that is what we do. We're an organization that exists in something like 22 countries throughout the world. It was originally founded in Brazil by the Brazilian thinker, Professor Plínio Correia de Oliveira, who started the Brazilian TFP in 1960.
And so recently you have had a number of rallies. You guys have rosary rallies, you have public prayer rallies, and then mm-hmm. you've been rallying to support the police. Tell me a little bit about that campaign.
We want to have a presence in the public square. We agree that we need to pray. We need to have the prayer is the foundation of all this. The spiritual life is the foundation. The sacraments are the foundation. But we also do need to project that image of prayer and in the public square. And so we hold what we call public square rosary rallies. On October 10th, we are going to have them, and we're going to have 20,000 of these rallies throughout the countries. We've been doing this for something like 15 years, so we've developed a system over the years where gradually it started with 1,000, 2,000, 3,000, now we're at 20,000 something. So we have 20,000 of these rallies, and they are a very good platform from which to project our ideals to the public. People see, well, these people are not afraid to affirm their faith. In the public square, it's not only for us to be out there, but all the people who see us, it really encourages them and say, well, there are people who really take their faith seriously. So that's what we do.
And the issue with the police is particularly significant because the police have been under so much generalized attack. I mean, it's much more than just saying this police officer did something he shouldn't have done or this department is corrupt. There's a general attack on law as such, and you guys, as advocates of order, have come to the fore and said, you know, no, we need our men in blue, our women in blue. We need these people.
We have asked them people to go in front of police stations and to pray the rosary. We give them a banner which says Saint Michael, protect our police, so they can protect us. And we had 3,000 of these rallies on September 26th. And we hope to have 3,000 more on October 31st. And the police are extremely appreciative. They just say, wow, you don't know how much it means to us that we see the public there supporting us and people honking and just, you know, sometimes you think, well, who's getting more out of this? The police or myself? Because I'm really, you see their appreciation. You say, wow, I'm doing something good.
Yes, yes. Now, another activity you guys have been involved in has been the Drag Queen Story Hour.
Oh, yes.
And that's been a big issue that has been well organized across the country of these, in cooperation with the National Library Association.
Right.
Put on these events in public libraries across the country. And people started writing to me, oh, Dr. Morse, what do we do? This is coming to our town. And I always told them there are two organizations I know that are doing something about it. One of them is Mass Resistance.
Right, yeah.
And the other one, whom you know, and the other one is TFP. And So if you show up at one of these things, you're sure to meet either the TFP or Mass Resistance, and often both.
And it's so necessary. I mean, we started to do that. Every time we saw one coming, we mobilized our activists in the area, and they got together, and they always have a rally. And before you know it, these Drag Queen Story Hours sort of went underground. They didn't announce when they were doing it. They were trying to not cause controversy. You've already accomplished something just by doing that.
Yes. And you know, here's the other point that I want to make about you guys. Is that there are not that many activist groups, what I would call Catholic activist groups or conservative activist groups, especially if you step away from the pro-life movement. The pro-life movement, there's a lot of activist activity out there, pro-lifers, for sure, across the religious spectrum. But once you get away from pro-life activity, most conservatives are kind of keyboard warriors or, you know, they're professionals, they're lobbyists or something like that, you know, and you need all that stuff.
But right,
there isn't that much, you know, grassroots, out in the street kind of activism. And you guys have really taken the lead on that.
We just see it's just so necessary, you know, if we have to be out there. And, you know, when the things come up, people come to us like they came to you and they say, what are we going to do? And we say, well, let's see what we can do. And
That's right. We have
this network. And we say, well, let's see if we can do something with this network and get it working.
And if you don't get it right the first time, you go back and try it again. You keep at it. Well, John Horvat, thank you so much for your time. This has been a very interesting discussion, wide-ranging discussion. I didn't know for sure where we'd end up, but I knew that it would be interesting, and it certainly has been edifying for me, and I'm sure for our viewers. Thank you so very much for being with me on the Dr. J Show.
It's been great. Thank you. It's just been great.
You've been listening to the Dr. J Show, a production of the Ruth Institute. The Ruth Institute equips Christians to defend the family and build a civilization of love. Check out our website at ruthinstitute.org for helpful resources and support. Join us on Facebook. Our podcasts can also be found online at ruthinstitute.org. I'm Father Mark Hodges. Thank you for watching.